Hello, I'm Bobby Galuba with OobaTech.com, and welcome to my fifth video recorded on Sunday, April 12th, 2015. Today, I'm going to show you a little bit of auto repair. Lately, my truck has been having a squeaking sound, but it only occurs when I go in reverse. My hunch is that it's the universal joint in the drive shaft, but I want to see. Other times when I've had this problem, it's been a symptom where it would squeak both it forward and in reverse, but this time it's just squeaking when I go in reverse. And I'll show you what it sounds, or I'll give you a demonstration of what it sounds like as well. I'm hoping that I can just get away with lubricating the universal joint, and I'm hoping I don't have to replace it. So, but let's take a look at it and see. Okay, what I'm going to do next is I'm going to drive my truck forwards and backwards to demonstrate that you can't really hear anything when I drive forwards, but when I put the vehicle in reverse, it squeaks, and it's an alternating squeak, so I'm pretty sure that it's the universal joint in the drive shaft. Now, my vehicle is a 2003 Chevrolet Avalanche, so let's see what it sounds like. Okay, so that's what it sounds like when I drive forwards and backwards, and hopefully the camera picked that up. Now, under normal circumstances, if you do proper maintenance during the regular schedule and you grease the fittings under your vehicle when you're supposed to, like during each oil change, you shouldn't have a problem with the universal joint squeaking. But unfortunately, I got a little behind on my maintenance and didn't grease the universal joints as often as I should. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to back the truck up onto these ramps that I have in front of me, and that'll give me a little more clearance to work underneath the truck. Now, these ramps are really good if you don't have a lift. Now, ideally, it's best to have a lift because then you can lift the vehicle up above your head and it's very easy to work on the vehicle. But I don't have a lift, so I'm going to use the next best thing, which would be these metal ramps. I've also put some plywood under each ramp to keep it from going from sinking into the dirt, hopefully. Okay, I'm a little bit too far back, so I'm going to pull a little bit forward. Almost came off there. So I'm going to pull a little bit forward to keep the vehicle from going off the back of the ramps there. Okay, so the truck looks like it's positioned well on the ramps. I feel pretty safe that it'll support it well. I've used these ramps many times before. One other thing I'm going to do just to make it a little bit safer, I've already set my emergency brake, but I'm also going to put some chocks underneath the front wheels. So always remember safety first. Okay, the next thing I'm going to do is chalk the front wheel, or one of the front wheels, and what I usually do is I keep a brick in my, actually two bricks in my truck that I bring along with me everywhere I go, just in case I ever need to chalk the wheels, like if I need to change a tire. So these are really good. You may be able to find some in a scrap yard or around the neighborhood, but I'm gonna take two of these and put one in the front of the front tire and one of the behind the front tire, and that'll really help to keep the really help to make sure that the truck doesn't roll at all. I definitely do not want it rolling while I'm underneath it. And also, hopefully, the grease fitting is positioned so that I can get access to it. Otherwise, I'm going to have to reposition the vehicle a little bit. So let's go ahead and place these chocks. I'll put one under the front and one under the back. And that should be enough to make sure that the vehicle doesn't roll. Now, before doing work under the vehicle and before doing work on any repair, the number one safety thing you want to remember is to always, always, always wear your safety glasses, like these stylish babies that I've got right here. See? Look pretty good, huh? Now, don't learn the hard way like I have in the past. Always wear these. It can cost you a lot of money, or it can cost you an eye if you get something in your eye. For example, I was cleaning off the battery terminals one time, and at the time I didn't think that I really needed safety glasses because I thought it was a pretty simple operation. But as I was scraping away the corrosion, a little piece of corrosion flew off from the bolt and went right up into my eye. Luckily, I was able to get it out of my eye pretty easily, but it was a lesson that I learned and I never forgot. So always, always, always wear your safety glasses when you're doing repairs. Now, in addition to safety glasses, another thing you might want to do, which will make your job easier and more comfortable to do, is to take the time to put something down underneath your truck. Like in this case, I have I put some sheets of plywood that I had in my garage down over the grass, and I also put an old moving blanket down that I have. This stuff is really good, and it will make it so that you can concentrate on your work and you don't have to worry about, while you're cranking on a part, some ant crawling down your leg or up your neck and getting stuck by sand spurs. So take the time, if you have some available, to put some plywood down or a blanket or even some sheets of cardboard. That works well too. I've used that in the past. So you want to make sure that you can concentrate on your work and not have to worry about something biting you or getting poked by something. Okay, I'm underneath my truck now, and I'm looking right at the universal joint. Here's the differential right here, the rear differential, the universal joint again, and then the drive shaft leading up to the front of the vehicle. Now, I was thinking that this universal joint had a grease fitting, which I could use to put some grease into it, but I looked around the whole universal joint, and I felt around, and unfortunately this one does not have any grease fitting, so I'm not gonna be able to grease it like I wanted to, and I'm gonna have to drop the drive shaft and inspect the joints of the universal joint. Now, to make my work a little bit easier, before I drop it, I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna get a new universal joint. Even though this one may be good, I can still save the new one for later, but it's best to, especially if you only have one vehicle, to go get all the necessary parts that you may need, even if you think you may not, have them available. Because once you start working on your vehicle, it's going to be much harder to go to the auto parts store if it's any more than, you know, walking distance or riding distance with a bike, and if you don't have somebody to take you there with another vehicle. So again, make sure you have all the parts necessary to work on your vehicle before you begin work. So in this case, I'm going to go get a new universal joint so that I have it available just in case I need it. And then once I get it, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take out, there's four bolts. I'm going to take out this one, this one, and this one. And remember, lefty-loosey, righty-tighty. So that means to loosen the bolts, you want to turn them counterclockwise. And that's generally the way it is on most bolts and nuts for vehicles and most other machinery. So again, we're going to take off this bolt here, this one here, this one here, and this one here. And what I'll probably have to do is use a pry bar and just push lightly on this to get the drive shaft to come loose, or to get the universal joint to come loose from these little blocks here. So let's go get a new universal joint. Okay, so I just got back from Napa Auto Parts. I bought a new universal joint for $16.04, including tax. And let me go ahead and I'll show it to you here. All right, it's this Napa Performer universal joint, and for my vehicle, it's part number P355, and again, this is the rear universal joint for a 2003 Chevy Avalanche. So I'm going to take the old one out and compare it to this new one. Also, this new one, let's go ahead and open it up. The reason why I got this one is because it has a grease fitting built into it. And if you see here, through the plastic, there's a little tiny metal tip right here that you can hook up your grease gun to and inject grease into it to lubricate the universal joint so that it won't squeak. And hopefully this one already has some in there, but I'm gonna add a little bit just in case. Okay, another piece of safety gear which I haven't mentioned yet is a good pair of gloves. Now, these are some crummy ones that I got for Christmas one year, I think, they'll still help to protect my hands. And when you're working on cars, especially if you've worked on cars for a long time, you'll have experience and know that you want to protect your hands so you don't get any knuckle busters. A lot of times when you're pushing really hard on a wrench, sometimes that wrench can come loose and you can end up bashing into another part on your vehicle, and it can really tear your hands up. So having a good pair of gloves is a good safety measure. So always remember, in addition to your safety glasses, have some gloves. Now, the tool I'm going to use to loosen the bolts that hold the universal joint in place is a combination wrench. And the brand of tools that I have Craftsman, of course, and some Snap-on stuff. But years ago, probably about over 15 or 16 years ago, I bought a set of tools by a company called Metrinch. I saw it on an infomercial, and I bought them because they allow you to work with both standard and metric bolts and fasteners. So let me show you what they look like. There's the logo on the case for my tool holder here. And let me zoom out. You can get an idea of what they look like. And I've got some other extra tools kind of mixed in there, but let me grab one of the combination wrenches. Okay, so here's a combination wrench. It's got an open end and a closed end here, and the reason why these Metrinch ones are good is because they have kind of a lobed outline. It's not the typical hexagonal outline that you would see with most wrenches that can only be used with either standard or metric. These can be used with both standard and metric, and another advantage is that they work with bolts and nuts that are rounded. So if you've got a bolt or a nut that you've rounded off the corners of and you can't get it to turn with a regular wrench, these Metrinch ones are really good. I don't know if they still sell them or not, but I'd highly recommend them if they're still available. So this is what I'm going to be using to take the bolts off that hold the universal joint in place. Okay, so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to loosen the four bolts and remove the four bolts that hold the universal joint in place. And I have to use a 7/16 inch combination wrench, and actually I'm gonna have to use my Craftsman one because my Metrinch 7/16 I broke years ago working on my brakes. So I'm gonna have to use my Craftsman one here, and I'll use this end here to get the best grip, the one that is the circular one. And remember, lefty loosey, righty tighty, so to loosen the bolts, turn them counterclockwise. I'll have to turn this around to get a little bit better clearance here. If you notice, the end is slightly angled so that you can either come at the bolt from this direction or you can come at it from this direction, and it'll allow you to have clearance on either side so that if there's a part in your way that's preventing you from turning the bolt, you can turn it the other way, and hopefully you'll have clearance and be able to turn it in this position. And I forgot to mention this, if you notice, on the bolts, they have six points on the bolts, but on here, it's 12 points. So that gives you a little more flexibility in positioning your wrench. So again, lefty-loosey, righty-tighty. I'm turning the bolt counterclockwise to loosen it. Take out the two bolts on this side, put them down on the blanket next to me, take this little cap off here, hopefully you can see that, there it is, oops, there's the other side, put those down, and then I'll take off the bolts from the other side. Don't mind my neighbor, he's hacking up a lung there. Yeah. Okay, so I got the other two bolts out of there. And this is kind of what they look like. They got hexagonal heads, and they're threads, and they go into this little U-shaped piece that holds the universal joint in place. Okay, so now what I'm going to do next is I'm going to try to just pop it out of here. Hopefully I won't need to use anything to pry it out of its position. Well, I think I will need something. I'll take my wrench and see if I can pry it loose. Okay, let's see if I can use this extension maybe. Okay, I think I'm gonna have to get a beefier wrench. Thank you. Okay, I think what I'm going to do, since it's since I'm having trouble getting it loose, is put some penetrating oil on it. So I'll be right back. Okay, I have some penetrating oil, but what I remembered also that I had that I have is a large crowbar. So here it is. I'm going to try using this baby to pop that universal joint loose. And I'm pretty sure if I can get it in there, I can get that universal joint loose, because it'll give me a lot of leverage. Let's try it around this way again. Okay, that may not fit. Let's see. There we go. Maybe there. Okay. Starting to come loose. Let's get it, see if I can get on the other side here. Try with another big wrench. Now, one thing that would have been advantageous that I could have done was prop up the back of the truck on jack stands and leave the wheels free and leave the transmission in neutral and the parking brake off so that I could turn the drive shaft. So right now I can't turn it because I've got the wheels on a ramp. So it's going to be harder for me to position it so that I can get the crowbar in there. So I'm going to have to try to get it the rest of the way out with my open-end wrench. Okay, so it's almost out of there. Let's try to put a little oil on there. Now this is a good reason to wear your safety glasses, is because you do not want to get oil in your eyes when you're spraying it. And I'm also going to cover it with my hands so that I don't get any on the camera. Okay, so I've got some oil on there, and let's see if it'll come the rest of the way out of there. You gotta be patient with these things. Let's try with the crowbar one more time. Well, I don't think I can quite get it out of there that way. Let's try this way here. Okay, I think what I'm going to try to do is put a screwdriver underneath one side of the universal joint and pry on the other side. Let's shove this little piece in there. Maybe that won't work. Let's try a little wrench, see if I can get that to wedge in there. Oh, not good. Broke that off. Okay. Well, we're not having much luck, but let's try again with the crowbar. Okay, still no luck, so I think I'm going to have to look for another better pry tool that's a little bit shorter, but will still give me more leverage, because I can't get in there with the crowbar. So I'll be back. Okay, so I'm back. I got two really big screwdrivers that I had in my toolbox. They're shorter than the crowbar, but hopefully they'll give me some, they're longer than the combination wrenches, and hopefully they'll give me some better leverage and allow me to get into that tight spot there, so that I can pry the drive shaft loose. So here's one of the screwdrivers. Sorry about that, lost you there. Okay, and then I'll show you the other screwdriver. This one here. And hopefully I can get it loose with these. Definitely being real uncooperative here. But you gotta have patience. Okay, well, this isn't going quite as planned, so I think what I'm going to have to do, I think what the problem may be is that the, since I have the vehicle up and the suspension may be positioned so that the drive shaft is too far forward and it doesn't have any more room to go forward in order for me to pop it out. So I think I'm going to have to bolt it back into position, take it off the stands, and I think what I'm going to do is put it up on jack stands and try it that way so that the rear drive shaft or the rear axle will be all the way down, and hopefully that will pull the drive shaft back a little bit from the engine, pull it out, and then allow me to have a little bit more room to push the drive shaft forward once I get it loose again. So I'm going to go ahead and take it off the ramp, or bolt it back in place, take it off the ramps, and put it up on jack stands. So I'll be back. Okay, I didn't want you to miss any of the steps, so I haven't bolted the universal joint back in place because I wanted you to see me doing that, just in case you're interested in seeing that step. Nothing real complicated, but I'm just going to bolt the universal joint back in place so that I can take my truck off the ramp. Put my gloves back on here. And I'll just finger tighten these for now, and then I'll tighten them down later with the wrench. When you're working under a car, sometimes you end up losing your part, so I had to look around for this one a little bit. Let me move the camera a little bit so you can see that a little bit better, hopefully. Zoom out a little. Oop, zoomed in. There we go. Now hopefully you can see a little bit better. Okay, and again, I've got my 7/16 combination wrench. We want to do righty-tighty, so turn the bolts clockwise to tighten them. Thank you.
Now, I forgot that I've got this Craftsman wrench here that it will act, it actually, because of the profile of it, it acts as a, it can work in a ratcheting motion. So hopefully you can see it on the camera here. I'm going to use this open end here that'll allow me to tighten it a little bit faster with a ratcheting motion. And as you can see, that goes a lot faster. I think this next one I'm going to have to use the open end because I don't have enough room for the ratchet. Okay, hopefully that's good enough for now, and I'm going to take it off the ramps and then put it up on jack stands. So, see you soon. Okay, by now you're probably thinking that this video is getting pretty drawn out, but I wanted to show you, especially you beginners, all of the steps that, or as many of the steps as I can, of what is involved in doing a repair, because usually when you're working on a car, things don't always go as planned. You always have to get around obstacles and improvise. So what have I learned so far with this repair? What I've learned is that I think what I'm gonna have to do in order to get that drive shaft out is, again, I'm gonna have to put the vehicle up on jack stands so that the back drive, so that the back axle can hang a little bit lower and the drive shaft will be farther back. And what that will hopefully allow me to do is, once I unbolt it again, it'll allow me to push the drive, it'll give me more room to push the drive shaft farther forward and release it from the U-shaped pieces that it's sitting in right now. And also, one thing I noticed is that when I took it off the ramps and then backed it up again, it didn't squeak. So I think just I probably could have gotten away with just lubricating Outside of the cups of the universal joints, where they sit in the little saddles, where they sit right about here. If you noticed, when I put the penetrating oil on there, I put it on there because it was all rusty, and I think that may have been where it was squeaking. So I probably could have gotten away with putting some oil on there, and it probably wouldn't have squeaked anymore. But since I've kind of torn up the seals on the universal joint, I'm gonna have to replace it anyways. So next thing I'm gonna do is put it up on the jack stands.
Okay, before I put it up on the jack stands, I want to give you one more demonstration to show you that it's not squeaking anymore. And I think, again, it's because outside of the cups of the universal joint, they were rusted a little bit, and also inside the saddle it was rusted a little bit where they sit. So let me show you that it no longer squeaks because I put some penetrating oil on there, and I think that's where the squeak was coming from. So I'm going to start it up, go forwards and backwards a few times, and show you that it's no longer squeaking. So actually I did hear a little bit of a squeak, but I think putting that penetrating oil on there did help just a little bit. But we're still going to replace the universal joint anyways, just because I busted up the seals. So let's go ahead and put it up on jack stands. Okay, now I think the best place for me to put my jack stand is right under this point right here, right under about here of the, of the frame, which there's one member that runs along the driver's side here. Here's the fuel tank right up there. So that goes up towards the front. And then back towards the rear suspension back here. And then there's a corresponding frame member on the other side, on the passenger side. So I'm gonna put my jack stand right under about here, and that will allow the drive shaft to drop down a bit, and hopefully I can get the frame up high enough with my floor jack to put the jack stands underneath it. And again, with the jack stands, what I'll do is I will put some plywood underneath them to keep them from sinking into the ground. So let's go ahead and put those jack stands in place. Okay, another thing before I start to put the truck up on jack stands is I wanted to show you what the jack stands were, and also show you my floor jack. Here are the jack stands. If you've never seen a jack stand, what it is it's a device to safely hold a vehicle up while you're working on it, because you don't want to have your floor jack just holding it, or whatever other jack that you have in your vehicle. That's very dangerous because it could slip and the vehicle could fall on top of you. So you want to have something solid like these two floor jacks here. Now the floor jacks, what they'll do is I'll put this piece underneath the rail of the frame on each side of the vehicle that I was showing you, and then I can also adjust them up and down. They have a little ratchet right there. You can see the ratchet, the little catches right here that it holds on. And then if you want to drop it back down again, you lift this lever and it drops straight down. So we'll put those underneath the frame to securely hold it. Now, I was talking to you about improvising. My jack stand is a little low on, my floor jack is a little bit low on hydraulic fluid, so I can't raise it as high as I normally would be able to if it was full of hydraulic fluid. So one way to improvise if you don't have any fluid is to give your floor jack a little bit of a boost by stacking it on some 2x4s, and I've actually done this before successfully and it worked pretty well. Just make sure you're not under the vehicle when you're jacking it up. So if you stack some 2x4s like this, you can give your floor jack a little bit of a boost if you can't get it to raise the vehicle as high as you would like to. So there's the floor jack, and these are the jack stands right here. So let's get to work again. Okay, I've got the floor jack in place, and if you notice, I gave it a little bit of a boost with the 2x4s, and I have each 2x4 directly positioned under each of the wheels of the jack stand, of the floor jack, because I want to have the weight directly over each one of the 2x4s. I don't want to have a chance of it falling over or anything like that. I want it to be as stable as possible. And I've done this before, but later I do plan to fill up my floor jack with some fluid, but I wanted to demonstrate this so you can see one way to improvise. So again, the 2x4s are directly under the wheels of the floor jack, and I have my jack stand ready to go, and I'll flip it up and I'll put it under the frame. So let's go ahead and start jacking it up. Okay, before I jack it up, I almost forgot some important things here to tell you. Since we're jacking up the rear end of the vehicle, setting the emergency brake isn't going to do any good to help to keep the vehicle from rolling. So we definitely want to put some chocks underneath the front tires. So I only have 3 chocks right now. So I put the 2 bricks that I carry with me under the front and back of the driver's side front wheel, or the driver's side front tire. And then over here, I have another little fold-up chock that I have under the front of the passenger side front tire. So make sure you put your chocks under there, because you definitely do not want your vehicle rolling, and setting the emergency brake isn't going to help if you have the rear wheels up in the air, because as far as I know, on most vehicles, when you set the emergency brake, it only brakes the rear wheels. I don't know of any vehicle where the front wheels are braked as well when you set the emergency brake. Okay, so I have my floor jack in place underneath, on top of the 2x4s to give it a little bit of a head start. Now I'm going to start jacking it up, and then I'll put the jack stand underneath the frame, and then I'll let it back down. So you want to jack it up slowly, just to so that you can monitor the vehicle to make sure it's not going to roll or move and fall. All right, so let's get going. Now the first thing I want to do is I want to tighten this little valve so that the hydraulic fluid will go into the large cylinder of the floor jack. And then I'll push it in and turn it, and then I'll start jacking it up slowly. And hopefully my floor jack won't move and it won't leak, because it had a little bit of a leak before. But let's see how high we can get it. And I want to jack it up enough so that the wheels are off the ground, because that'll make it easier for me to move the drive shaft if I need to. I can rotate the wheels and also rotate the drive shaft. So let's check, just take a quick look underneath. Okay, it looks like it's still under the frame. Okay, well, it looks like my floor jack is petering out, and I'm not going to have enough range to get the wheels completely off the ground. But I think this may help to at least make it so that I can get the drive shaft out.
And then what I'll do next is I'll release the fluid and allow the jack, or allow the floor jack to drop and allow the frame of the vehicle to sit on the jack stand. Now, what I'm going to do so that I can get the wheels off the ground, I think I'm going to put one more level of 2x4. 2x4 is underneath the jack stand, underneath the floor jack, so that I can jack it up a little bit higher. Maybe one or two more levels of 2x4s.
Okay, I've added two more levels of 2x4s underneath my floor jack to give it a little boost. Now, again, the sensible thing would be to add some fluid to my floor jack, so that I can get it to go its full range, but this is a way to improvise if you can't do that, and I wanted to show you that. Now, as I was doing this, I remembered that I could probably just get away with getting one wheel off the ground, because there's a differential, of course. And differentials, what a differential gear set does is it allows the inside wheel on a turn to travel slower than the outside wheel on a turn, and because of this, when you have one wheel off the ground, it will allow the wheel that's off the ground to spin while the wheel that's on the ground can stay in place, even though they're part of the same axle. So I think I can just get away with jacking up one wheel off the ground, and that will hopefully allow me to turn the drive shaft and allow that wheel to spin as well. So let's go ahead and start jacking it up some more.
Make sure the valve's closed. Insert the rod into the actuator. Now I don't have much room to move it, so we're going to have to go in small increments here. Hopefully that'll make it so that I can at least get one wheel off the ground.
Let's check it, see if it's staying in place.
And again, make sure you're not under the vehicle when you're doing this, and make sure nobody else is underneath it, just in case it falls. Okay, I think that's about all I'm going to be able to get out of my floor jack. If you can see, the seal is starting to fail, and it happened before as well, so that's why it's a little low. So I think I'm going to have to fix that seal later on and fill it up with some fluid. But let's reposition the jack stand and see if I can get this drive shaft off. Okay, so I've got it up a little bit higher. I've got the jack stand up a little bit higher. Now I'm gonna lower the floor jack. Okay, so putting the vehicle up on a jack stand did help. I was able to undo the bolts for this and get the drive shaft loose. So now I can just pull it out, I'll drop it down, and then I'll pull it out from the front up there. And let's see if I can do this while I'm here. Let's orient the camera here. Let's see if I can just do it with one hand. Well, maybe not. Okay, so I've got the camera in place on a little wobbly stand here, and I'm going to try to pull the drive shaft out
with both hands here. And it's going to come out of the output of the automatic transmission. And let's see if we can get it out of there. Okay, there we go. All right. So try not to scratch up the surface of the part of the drive shaft that goes into the transmission. Let's just see if we can safely set it down on the plywood here. And there we go, got the drive shaft out. So that's what it looks like. And we'll take a closer look at it after I get it out of the out from underneath the truck. Okay, I finally got the drive shaft out from underneath the truck, and here it is. I've got it on the moving blanket that I have. Just wanted to keep it from getting scratched up on the concrete. There's the full length of it. In fact, you can see these right here. I believe these are weights, balance weights, that are put on at the factory when it's assembled. Just to take out any imbalance in the drive shaft. So, but let me show you what I found. When I was taking it out, I did kind of gash up the, tear up these little seals. So I'll definitely have to replace the universal joint here. And these cups right here that connect to the differential, they rotate fairly smoothly and seem to be still lubricated. But let me show you what I found here. This one, I can barely move it. And hopefully you can hear it squeaking. Now that one's really tough to move. So let's take that apart and see what it looks like inside. Okay, now here's the end of the drive shaft that goes into the output of the automatic transmission. And this one, this universal joint, let's raise it up a bit here. I can move it, this joint back and forth, and it seems pretty smooth. And I can move this joint back and forth, and it seems pretty smooth. So I think I'm going to just leave that one in there and go ahead and grease it, because this one does have a grease fitting. And there's the grease fitting right there. I'll clean it off just a little bit with my glove, and you can see the little check ball there that allows the grease to go in but doesn't allow it to go out. And then you always want to double check to make sure that these rings are still in place and that they're not broken. And this one looks good. This one looks good. Looks like it's in place and not broken. This one looks good. Alright. And then the last one looks good. So all of the retaining rings look like they're in good condition, so I'll leave those there as well. I'm just gonna put a little bit of grease in that joint, in that universal joint. And in case you didn't notice, and if you've never heard of a universal joint, what it allows is it allows two axes which aren't parallel to be connected to each other and rotate. So normally there's going to be a slight difference in the angle of the axes of these, of the main part of the drive shaft and the portion that goes into the transmission. And as the drive shaft rotates, it allows the two pieces to stay connected but be have their axes where they're not parallel. So otherwise, if this was fixed, both portions would have to be parallel with each other in order for it to rotate, otherwise it would just snap. So that's what a universal joint does. It allows the mechanical rotating motion of this axis to be transferred to this axis right here, which is at a slightly different angle. And if you see here, it rotates up and down and left and right. Right, so that's a universal joint, and they're very common in vehicles. The one problem, as far as I know, with universal joints is that it can kind of result in a little bit of a pulsation or a little bit of a pulsing motion because it's not completely smooth. I believe there are some different joints which are called CV or continuous velocity joints, which are common on front-wheel drive vehicles and allow a smoother rotation of the drivetrain. So let's go ahead and we'll take apart that defective universal joint. Okay, the first thing I'm going to do to hopefully make it easier for me to do this repair and to remove the old universal joint is to spray some penetrating fluid on there. I've got some WD-40. I'm going to spray it on both cups that are in the drive shaft. So let's go ahead and spray some on here. Let it start working its way in. And let's turn it around. Whoops. Don't want to let the other end touch the concrete and get scratched up. So let's move this camera just a bit and adjust it there. And we'll spray some more on this side. Now the next thing I have to do, and hopefully I can do it without moving it out of the range of the camera, is to take the retaining rings out of each side of the universal joint. So let's see if I can go ahead and do that. Also, before I do that, I wanted to show you, I've got a pair of needle nose pliers right here. I've got a pair of adjustable pliers here. Not quite sure which one is going to fit in there the best, because I haven't done this repair in several years. And then I have another set of a small adjustable wrench right here. So I'm going to have all three of those available, and hopefully at least one of them will allow me to take those two retaining rings out of the drive shaft so that I can remove the universal joint. Okay, so let's just try the needle nose. In fact, I gotta lubricate my needle nose pliers here. I've been sitting in my toolbox for a while in my truck, and they had a bit of moisture. So let's lubricate those, and what I'll do is hold it here and squeeze it, and there we go. Got that one out. So those needle nose worked really well. Let's rotate the drive shaft a bit. Make sure you can still see it there in the camera. Let me zoom in a little bit so you can get a little bit better view, hopefully. And I'll take the next one out. So again, I'll squeeze the two halves of the retaining ring together. Oops. It's hard to do this and film at the same time. So squeeze them together. Oops. Slipped out a little bit. Let's try again. Hold them in place. Okay, got it squeezed, and now it's out. So there's the retaining ring that I just took out, and these two pieces hold the cups of the universal joint in place inside the drive shaft. And when I purchased the new universal joint, I got some replacements for these. So I'm going to get rid of these and put in the new ones. Okay, the next step I'm going to take is to drive the universal joint out of the drive shaft. And before I do that, though, I want to mention one other piece of safety equipment. I not only have my gloves on now and my safety glasses, but I also have some earplugs because I'm going to be pounding on this thing and it might get kind of loud. Now, it may sound kind of goofy, but later on when you're an old geezer, you don't want to go around not being able to hear anybody. So make sure you wear your earplugs. All right, so to drive the universal joint out of the drive shaft, what I'm going to use is this socket. Now, I don't need it to turn the universal joint. I'm just going to use it because it fits fairly well in that hole, and I can hit it with my hammer. Now, I'm going to try to see if I can get away with just hitting it with the rubber mallet that I have so that I don't tear up my socket too much. And if that doesn't work, I've got a regular hammer. So here's my rubber mallet. And here's my regular hammer just in case I need it.
Alright, so let's go ahead and try to drive that out. Now, this one is from my Metron set, and it's a 3/4 inch socket. Also fits a 19 millimeter nuts. So 3/4 and 19 millimeter. So let's see if we can use that to drive the universal joint out of the drive shaft. Okay, I think I'm gonna have to use the regular hammer. Okay, I think it's coming out just slowly but surely. Got poked by a little sand spur there. See if I can get rid of the seal out of the way. Oh, one of the cups came off. Okay, so there we go. See if I can get it the rest of the way out. Ah. Alright, now you can already see, I just took that little cup out, and you can already see that it's all dry in there. All dry and rusty. So this was definitely the problem, and definitely what was causing it to squeak. And if I would have let it go too long, those pins would have eventually turned to dust, which the last time I had to replace the universal joint, that's exactly what happened. It basically turned to dust, and you couldn't even see any pins in there. So you don't want to let it go too long once you start hearing your universal joint squeak. You want to try to replace it as soon as possible, or at least lubricate it. Because if you let it go too long, the drive shaft could actually drop out of the vehicle, and that could cause a real problem and a lot of damage. So here we go. Here's the pins of the cup, and it's all dried out. Let me grab the other one, and you can see how they're still lubricated. Okay, this is the other one, and if you see there, there's still grease inside there, and that one was turning smoothly. And that's how they should look. They should have grease in there, and none of the pins should be dry. They should all be lubricated. So, now I'm not sure if that universal joint was the original one that was in the vehicle, or if one that I had replaced before. But I don't want to replace it. I don't want to replace it with another one that does not have a grease fitting on it. So that's why I bought one with a grease fitting. So hopefully, the one with the grease fitting will fit in there properly, and once I have it in there, hopefully I'll be able to get access to it in order to grease it. Sometimes it can be very difficult, and sometimes you have to have like a needle tip on your grease gun in order to get to the grease fitting, because a regular broad tip, which goes over the entire grease fitting, sometimes does not have enough room to access the grease fitting. Alright, so let's see if we can get the rest of this universal joint out of there. Okay, so here we go. Here's the universal joint. Here's the part of the joint that was dry and was squeaking. Here's the part that was still lubricated. and I'll take the other two cups off, and this one is probably still lubricated. Yep, see, that's still got some good grease in there. Put that down, and let's take the other one off, and let's see if that one's, I may not be able to get this one off. Oh, there we go. Okay, so this one still has some grease in there, and it still looks good. But the other one, that one was definitely dry, it was rusted out, and that's where our squeak was coming from. So, and if we wouldn't have done anything about it, the rest of these probably would have dried out eventually, and if I would have gone too long, it could have probably worn out enough to where the drive shaft could have come loose or made, you know, quite a bit of racket. So you definitely want to grease these on a regular basis, and this one unfortunately has no grease fitting, so I couldn't grease it. But the ones that do have the grease fittings, you want to make sure you grease them. And I'll get the other one and we'll compare, I'll get the replacement and we'll compare the two. Okay, the next thing I want to do is show you the replacement universal joint. first thing you'll notice is that it has the grease fitting there. So when the universal joint's in the drive shaft and the drive shaft's mounted in the vehicle, hopefully I'll be able to get access or get enough access to this little grease fitting so that I can inject some grease into there and keep all of these joints lubricated. Now I was thinking about how I wanted to orient it in there, whether I wanted this side to be facing the drive shaft or whether I wanted this side to be facing the drive shaft, but it really doesn't matter because this grease fitting doesn't protrude off to one side more than the other. It just goes straight out the side. Alright, now the next thing you'll notice is that there's two different types of cups on here. You've got these two here, which have these little grooves right here, and then these two here. Now, these two will go in the drive shaft, right about here. Okay, these two here will go in those saddles of the, I believe it's the pinion shaft that goes into the differential. I think I may be wrong on that name, I'm not sure, but basically these mount in the little saddles that are present on the shaft that goes into the differential. Okay, so first thing I'm going to need to do, and actually let me show you the other pieces that came with the universal joint. We've got some new retaining rings. Okay, so I can replace the old ones with these new ones, and that's what I'm going to do, because the old ones, even though they're not broken, they may be kind of fatigued, and so they may be prone to cracking later on. So we're going to put these new ones in. And then the next thing is this C-shaped retainer. And what that's going to do is it's going to keep the cups that go into the drive shaft right here, it's going to keep them from popping out. So these C-shaped rings, once I get the universal joint cups driven into the drive shaft, I'm going to have to put these rings and drive them over the cup to keep it from going this way out of the drive shaft. Okay, and then also to keep them from being, or to stop them from going out, we're going to have the retaining rings on top as well. So they'll be pretty secure in there. So let's go ahead and we'll clean up the drive shaft and work on putting this universal joint inside it. Now again, I've got my earplugs on because later on I'm going to be pounding on this thing and I don't want to screw up my hearing. Now another thing I have, another little tip, is I keep a stash of old paper towels and these little, I think they're like little Clorox wipes, and these things are pretty tough, and once you use them to, you know, clean surfaces, you can still use them for cleaning up grease. So I keep an old box, I keep a box of the old ones out in my garage. It may sound kind of gross, but man, they sure do come in handy for cleaning up grease when you're working on cars. And I think one more thing I'll do is get my wire brush just to give it a final cleanup. Okay, so I've got two brand new wire brushes that I had sitting around in my toolbox. And this one here, it's made out of steel. And I believe that has a bit more bite than this one here, which is made out of brass. So let's go ahead and we'll clean it up a little bit more with the steel one. I just wanted to show you the brass one. There it is. So let's go ahead and clean up that universal joint a little bit better. I want to clean out the groove that the retaining ring goes in. Clean out the other groove. And just clean it up in general. Doesn't have to be too clean. Okay, so now we're ready to go ahead and put the universal joint in there, and I'm going to spray a little bit more of the WD-40 on there to make it easier for it to go in. Okay, so I'm going to take one of these cups off here. And if you see, it's lubricated, and there are the pins, all nice, clean, shiny, and lubricated. All right, and I want to try to keep it as clean as possible. Okay, I think I'm gonna have to take both of them off, actually. And then I'll drive one in and then drive the other one in. Okay, I'm gonna have to think about this for a little bit. I can't quite remember how I got this in there the last time. Okay, I think what I'm gonna do is I remove this seal because I don't want to tear it up, and I'm gonna try to put it in there, drive it through without the seal on there. Actually, I may have to do it anyways because I'm gonna have to do the other side. I think I'll have to drive that seal through there. So let's go ahead and at least put one on there and drive it through. Or put one, put the universal joint in there without one of the seals on and see if we can get it through. Actually, that may not be a good idea. So I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna put this seal back on and drive it in there. Hopefully all of those pins stayed where they were supposed to. So let's turn it over. If you can see that there. Okay, that didn't work. Gonna have to get another one with a seal. I did that wrong. So we're gonna have to buy another drive or another universal joint. So we'll have to continue this tomorrow. Okay, it's Monday, April 13th, 2015, and I'm back. I went this morning to Napa and bought another universal joint since I screwed up the first one. I accidentally screwed up the seal. Those of you who are watching the videos that I made yesterday where I screwed up the seal, you probably realized the stupid mistake that I made and were screaming at me. But for those of you who didn't, for those of you who don't realize what mistake I made, let me show you. Oh, and I also, before I show you the mistake I made, I also bought this. This is a little needle adapter, a needle point adapter that you can use to get into tight spaces where you can't get to the grease fitting otherwise with a regular nozzle that goes over the grease fitting. This particular one, let me open it up here. Had to get this since I lost my other one. This particular one has a really... Let's take that off. It has a really tiny needle point that you can use to get into tight spaces that you couldn't normally get into with a regular grease gun nozzle. So this is one thing that's handy to have when you have to lubricate universal joints. Let's put that back. Okay, so let me show you the stupid mistake that I made. And it's good to, you know, make mistakes sometimes because you learn from them. And hopefully when you watch the explanation that I give and you see my mistake and how I realized what I did, hopefully you won't make the same dumb mistake that I did. Okay, so here's the universal joint, and one thing that I did that was a mistake, here, let me set that down, I want to take these gloves off, try to keep it as clean as possible. The one mistake that I made is that I had forgotten that it's these two caps right here that go into the axle at these points here, not these two. Okay, so the ones with the grooves, they actually sit in the input of the differential, the two little saddles to the input of the differential. Okay, but these two, they go here and here. Now, also, the diameter of these two is slightly smaller than the diameter of these. And that's the reason why I was having trouble getting these to go in there, and that's why I screwed up the seal. So let's see if we can see a little comparison. Again, there's the grease. Now, these aren't completely, these don't have enough grease, really, to be reliable for a long period of time after you assemble them. So you need to add some grease to them before you start using them. So let's see if we can see the difference in diameter there. If you look, you can see that the one on the right is just slightly smaller in diameter than the one on the left. And so that's the reason why I was having trouble. I should have been using the cap on the right to go into the axle and not the cap on the left to go into the axle. So now, let's see if I can get it together correctly. Okay, I'm gonna put a little bit of grease on my finger and grease up these holes here on the axle to hopefully make it a little bit easier for the parts to go in. Just a thin coating. Okay, so I'm going to take the cap off of this one here and try to keep the, you definitely want to make sure that the roller bearings stay where they're supposed to. And if you see here, this one fits in much easier and the seal goes in and I don't have to worry about breaking the seal. Okay, I'm gonna put this down in there. Actually, let's pull this out just a little bit. A little tricky. Oops, let's take both sides off. See, when you're not a professional, and you don't do this on a regular basis, you only do this type of repair every few years, then you forget, which is what I did. Okay. There we go. Drive that one in. Tap that in with my hammer. Let's see here. And again, I have my earplugs on. Okay, leave that right about there, start driving this one in, again make sure that you don't have any dirt in there. Make sure that the roller bearings are in place. Okay, so I'm going to drive this the rest of the way in here. Okay, so now what I'll do is I'll get my socket so that I can drive it in the rest of the way. Okay, I've got my socket, so now I'm going to drive the caps into the axle the rest of the way. Let's check to see if I have it down far enough. Maybe a little bit farther. One more tap. Okay. Now we can see the groove for the retaining ring right there. Okay, now let's drive the other one in. Okay, they're moving freely. Let's see if we can get the new retaining rings in there. Again, I've got these two replacement retaining rings. I'll put those in there. Okay, got my pliers here. Okay, I'll pound down that socket a little bit, or pound it down just a little bit more to get those retaining rings to go in place. Okay. I think we got that one. Now I'll do the other side. Okay. Okay, so there we go. It's in the drive shaft. I've got the two retaining rings in place. There's the other one. In fact, let's drive this retaining ring in a little bit farther if we can. Okay, I think that's good. Still moving. A little tight, but I think that'll be all right. Okay, and the seals aren't damaged either, like I did the last time. Okay, now I'll put these two C-shaped clips on there. Okay. All right, so I've got these on there. Now, I don't want to put it in the vehicle yet. I want to grease it. All right, so let's turn it around, find that grease fitting. Let's see. Here's my grease gun. Let me get to where I can see what you're seeing. Here's my grease gun, and I hope this is the one that works. I have two of them, and one of them's not working quite right, but I think this one may be the one that's working. So it's got a little plunger here that pushes the grease up the cylinder every time you squeeze this trigger. This is spring-loaded, and so it helps to push the grease up, and as you squeeze the trigger, it comes out the little nozzle here. And this is a typical nozzle on a grease gun. But sometimes this is too big to get into a tight spot like a universal joint. So sometimes you have to use that little needle point that I was telling you about. So let's see if this will fit in the universal joint or on the nozzle of on the grease fitting for the universal joint when it's out of the vehicle right now. Few squirts. Okay. I can feel it kind of pushing on the caps every time I pump it, so I think that's probably good. And if you see here, That's a little bit of grease that just came out that I squeezed. So clean that up. And again, it's good to have some old paper towels lying around. Ones that you've already used for, you know, maybe your breakfast or something. And the car doesn't care if it's dirty. But it's a great way to have some free paper towels that you can clean up greasy messes with. Then we'll clean this up a bit too. Let's just inspect actually one of these just to see how much grease we've got in there. If that may be enough. I think I'm gonna squirt a little bit more in there. Let's see this one. Okay, so this one you can definitely tell that the grease was getting down in there, but I think I'm gonna give it a few more squirts here. Okay, I think that's about all I can do right there. Because it's starting to ooze out, this one here. If you see here, it's starting to come out. Maybe you can get a better view this way. Oops, I don't want to take that off. Put it back on. Okay, so let's clean that up, that grease. Get that excess off there. Throw that to the side. All right. So there we go. We got one of them in there, and I'm gonna grease the other one. I think the other one's still good. I just want to grease it before we put it back in the vehicle. So let's set that one up and we'll grease it. Okay, so here's the other end of the axle, or of the drive shaft that goes into the output of the transmission. And so this one, it still moves fairly freely. I don't hear any squeaks or anything, and I think it's in good condition. It has a grease fitting right here. If you can see that, there's a little grease fitting. And so I'm gonna clean that off and inject some grease into this universal joint. You want to get that grease fitting nice and clean so that you're not injecting grease into the universal joint. Excuse me, so that you're not injecting dirt into the universal joint. Okay, so I'll grab my grease gun again. Here it is. Well, I'm not quite sure if I'm really getting much in there. I think what I'm going to try to do is poke the ball down on that grease fitting. Okay, so it's still springy in there. I'm gonna try shooting some grease in there again. Okay, I had to pause there for a little bit, but let's inject a little bit more grease into there. I think check ball and that grease fitting was a little stuck, so when I pushed it down, it seemed to free it up, and I think I may have been on there at just the wrong angle as well. Okay, if you can see, maybe a little difficult to see here, but it's starting to come out the seal on the side here, so I think that's about all I'm going to be able to squirt into there, but I know that at least some of the grease got in there. Okay, so it's greased up, and I think I'll clean it off the rest of the way. And once I do that, actually, what I'm going to do is take some more grease and grease up the shaft that goes into the output of the automatic transmission as well. So let me grab another rag. Okay, so that should be clean enough, I think. And I think what I'll do is wait to grease that till just before I stick it in the vehicle, because I don't want to get dirt all over it. Okay, now here's a little trick that I just thought of. To hopefully keep these two caps from falling off when I'm putting the drive shaft in, because I definitely do not want them falling off, since if the needle bearings or the roller bearings in there, if they fell out, they'd get all dirty and I have to clean everything all up. I put these are produce rubber bands from the grocery store. A lot of times when you buy broccoli or other stuff, they'll have these rubber bands around there. So I save these just in case I need them for something, and they really came in handy for this particular purpose. So they're pretty beefy and pretty tight, and I think they'll do a good job of holding these two caps on the universal joint as I'm mounting it inside the vehicle. Okay, so there's a little tip for you. Okay, I'm back under my truck, and I have to say that working on a car is hard enough, but working on a car and trying to film it at the same time is really tricky. So the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to put the drive shaft into the output of the transmission, and I already cleaned off the seal right here. This is the output seal, or this is the seal for the output of the transmission. I cleaned that off, and I'm going to put a little bit of grease on the drive shaft to lubricate it. Okay, so I got a dab of grease here. I'm gonna smear it on the drive shaft. And maybe get a little bit more. Ouch. Okay, I think that should be pretty good. Okay, and those, looks like that is rubber bands that I put on there are helping. Okay, let's see if I can feed this through here. Okay, there we go. Got that in place. And it looks like my cap stayed on my universal joint too. Those rubber bands really helped. So if you ever do this job, get some of those big old rubber bands to hold the caps on the universal joint. So I'm gonna move on down and put in the other end. Okay, I'm back. I've got the drive shaft in place now. I had to take the drive shaft out of the transmission and rotate it a little bit so that it would be aligned right with the input to the differential. So I had to make sure they were lined up correctly here. So I'm gonna take these, actually what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna put a little bit of grease in these little saddles here and then on the caps just to make it so that hopefully it'll be easier next time to take them off. So let's get the grease gun here again. Put a little grease on my finger. I'll put it in the saddles. And I'll put it on the caps. I'll put it on the caps here. This is what I mean by the caps. Let's see if you can see them there. These. Put a little bit in there. And do the same thing for the other one. Let's get the other one. Put some grease in there. And as you're working underneath a car, or under a truck, another thing you'll learn is how to move like an inchworm, because that's basically the only way you can slide back and forth underneath these things. Okay, so I'm gonna take my rubber bands off here. I wanna be careful to hold the caps so that the caps don't pop off accidentally. I don't wanna have to be cleaning them up again. But these rubber bands did an excellent job of holding the caps in place, so if I do this job again, I'm definitely gonna use these rubber bands. So let's pull it down and okay, so now it's in place and I can put the caps on. And another thing you want to do when you're working underneath a car is really think ahead and try to think about what tools you're going to need and what parts so that you don't have to keep sliding in and out from underneath the vehicle, and have them in a place where you can easily get to, because it's going to be hard to move your arms underneath the vehicle. That's why it's so nice when you have a lift, or at least you're able to put it up on some high jack stands, and then you can sometimes use a creeper, which is a little cart that you can use to slide underneath a vehicle. It's real low, it has a really low profile, it has four wheels, and you can lie on your back on it and slide in and out from underneath a car. Okay, so I've got one cap on. I'm gonna put the next cap on. And it's a good thing I put this plywood down and these and the moving blanket. Because even with that stuff, I've had some trouble with sand spruce, because they're all over in my yard, unfortunately. Okay, and again, this is a 7/16 inch wrench that I'm using to tighten these bolts with. Forgot it. This has a ratchet action on these that I can use. Okay, so I'm tightening these babies down here. Sorry, it's a little tough to make it so you can see everything, but hopefully you can get somewhat of an idea of what I'm doing. Now this ratchet action works pretty well, but if the bolt's a little too loose, let me slide back over here so you can see. If the bolt's a little too loose, then it doesn't work very well. Okay, so we get that one tight. Let's try this one here, try to finger tighten it a little bit more, go a little faster. And again, with working on cars, you just have to have a lot of patience because it takes a long time and you can run into a lot of roadblocks. And you have to be able to improvise and think through the problem and just stay calm and cool. Sometimes there's a lot of cussing too. Okay, just about done, and there may be a torque setting for these. I'm not sure what it is, I didn't look it up, but just hand tightening them to about as tight as you can get them. It should probably be more than sufficient. I think that's what I've always done in the past, and I've never had any of these come loose before either. But if you can find out the torque setting, it's always good to know. And use a torque wrench if possible. A torque wrench is a tool that allows you to tighten a bolt or a nut to a particular tightness, a particular torque or twisting force. And the way a lot of them work is that they'll have either a spring that will move along a scale, and you'll see that, or you can set them to a certain torque, and then once you get to that torque, they'll click. Move over here to get a little bit better leverage. Okay, I'll do one last inspection, but I think we're set. I think they're all tight enough. Okay, let me clean up my fingers here and then I'll bring you in for a close-up shot. And you can see what it looks like when it's done. Gotta get all the grease off of my fingers out. Don't wanna get that all over the camera. Your shirt makes a good rag too. Okay, so let's take a close-up look of the drive shaft. Let's zoom out a little. Okay, so here's the universal joint and the drive shaft. Here's the drive shaft and the universal joint after it's all been installed. You can see the retaining ring is in there in place. I've got the caps on and the cap bolts. Here are the other bolts over here, the other cap. And let's see if you can, inside there, you can see that little C-shaped retainer that we installed. And let's take a look over here underneath there. That looks good, I think. A little bit of grease. That's all right, it'll come off eventually. It'll get dirt stuck onto it and either stick there or come off. No big deal. Okay, so here's the other side. And oh no. Wait a minute. It's all right. Okay, we've got the retaining ring up here. And then to keep this cap in, we've got the little C ring inside there, which I don't think you can see from here, but so that's it. We've installed the drive shaft. Here's a view all the way up to the transmission. And just to let you know, which I didn't let you know before, the input to the transmission is splined, so that it has little grooves that run the length of it. So you have to make sure you get it aligned properly, so that you can put the universal joints inside this little saddle right here. So, but I think that's it. We'll take it down, take the vehicle down, and give it a little test drive. Okay, I've got it all back together again, and I've got my truck back down on the ground. Now, I couldn't just jack up the floor jack, take the jack stand out, and then let the floor jack down all the way, because it would hit the running board that I have right here. So just as we brought it up in increments and small increments, where I would I put that little booster underneath it with the 2x4s, and then I would jack it up, put the jack stand underneath it, drop it down on the jack stand, then put a few more 2x4s underneath it, jack it up a little bit more, and then put the jack stand higher, and then set it back down on the jack stand. I set it back down on the jack stand. I had to take it down in increments as well. So what I would do would, lift up the vehicle with the floor jack. I would drop the jack stand down a few notches, then bring the floor jack down so that it didn't have any weight on it and the weight was on the jack stand. I would take out one set of 2x4s, then put the floor jack on the 2x4s again, jack it up, drop the jack stand another few notches, and then repeat the process until I got it all the way down and on the ground. So again, we brought it up in short increments and then brought it down in short increments. So now let's go ahead and test drive it and see what it sounds like. Thank you. All right, so there we go. I think we're set. And I think we've got everything back together in one piece. And I didn't hear any squeaking. So I think we're done. Okay, so we're done with the repair. We tested it out. We replaced that universal joint. Looks like it's working well. No more squeaks. So I think we're good to go. And hopefully that repair will last for a long time, especially now that we have a universal joint on there that we can grease. It's got a grease fitting. So anytime I change my oil, I can grease the fitting, or the two fittings on the on the universal joints on either end of the drive shaft. And also I can grease the suspension links as well. If you're ever looking underneath your car, a lot of the suspension components will have grease fittings as well that you can grease to keep them well lubricated. So, since this is my first video on auto repair, since this is my first auto repair episode, I want to dedicate it to my friend Garvin. Now, Garvin, he's a longtime friend of mine and a mechanic, and when I was in middle school, when I was a kid, he would pick me up on Saturdays. We'd go eat biscuits and gravy, and then we'd go down to his shop and work on cars for most of the day. And man, that was fun. I got to got to learn how to do oil changes. I did alignments. I even got to rebuild a V6 engine one time with his help. So this episode, Garvin, this one's for you, buddy. Thanks a lot. All right, everyone. Thanks for hanging in there, and if you watched the whole video, I really appreciate it, and I know it was long, but hopefully you learned from my mistakes, and have a good one. Take care.